I just asked Marc to do was to sign in to our book. Are you aware that every Sunday we have this book out here, the New York Society for Ethical Culture in New York City, and we ask the presider and the speaker to sign. So these go back a long, long time. So you're now part of our history, and we thank you so much for that.
I'm honored.
I'm going to start with the we're going to be having a conversation. I've been asking you some questions, but I want to start with a quotation from one of your first films, Slam, from 1998. Never give anyone the power to take away your freedom. I think that has been a theme through so much of your work, hasn't it? That you're telling those stories and giving folks an opportunity to tell their stories. And I just want to thank you so much, because you, in doing that, you've given these people voice, but you've also shared that with all of us. So first of all, much appreciation for that. And what inspired you for that film?
Well, maybe a little out there. Slam was a film that was inspired by a number of films I had done in jails and prisons. In fact, I was making a film for HBO at the time called Thug Life in D.C., which was about mass incarceration, really, before that became a popular phrase, because here is the nation's capital. This was in 1997, the majority of people locked up in Washington, D.C.'s jails were young African-American males. And here we were in the capital of the United States. This is during the Clinton era. And yet we were locking up all these people in our nation's capital. So it kind of grew out of that. And as you referred, it was the story of a young pot dealer, you know, but who was also a poet. And that the way to free ourselves, the way to find a way out, not only of the jail cell, but if you use that as a metaphor, we're all locked into something and trying to get free, trying to break free and be a fuller human being. And for me, the way has always been through the imagination, through creativity. Through new ideas, and in this sense we acted that out by bringing Saul Williams, who was a fairly well-known spoken word artist and slam poet, Sony Soane, who went on to star in the television series The Wire, and two or three other actors into the D.C. jail. And we worked with real detainees in the D.C. jail, and we made the movie in 2 weeks. And the only, you know, when I think back on it, the movie could never be made today. I think the reason the movie was made, obviously, because I had done Thug Life in D.C., I knew the officials, I knew the warden of the jail, and I knew the head of the Department of Corrections, who was a tough cookie. She was a woman, conservative, and what happened was that the Republican Congress at that time, the impeachment hearings were going on, and Mayor Barry was reelected in the city of Washington. And that was after he had his issues with a drug boss, a crack incident, and the Republican Congress was so furious that the citizens of Washington had elected Barry again that they defunded the city. And Margaret, who was the head of corrections and was a Republican, was known as kind of an iron fist. She was so outraged that this had happened. And I was sitting in her office, and this was playing out on C-SPAN, and she turned to me and she said, "I'll give you 2 weeks. Do whatever you want." And so that is kind of how Slam happened. Because if we had to get insurance and risk assessment and all the other things that you normally would have to do to make a feature film, there's no way it would happen, including being able to work with actual detainees and corrections officers. And just to bring that full circle, two elements. One, I have a film called Rikers that premiered this fall here in New York City and at the Doc NYC Festival and on Channel 13, and it's going to be on PBS nationally in May. So in a way that's coming full circle because the first or the second time I ever went to Rikers was to visit Bones Malone, who was an actor in the film Slam. And at first I was considering him for the lead in the film. And he got involved in some kind of assault issue. I took the bus out there with all the families and waited hours, and finally we met in the visiting section. And we basically had a creative session, a script session, on this film, Slam, that we were developing. And I said, Bones, this is going to be a little tricky with you in jail. And I don't think we're going to be able to film this in Rikers. And, you know, what are we going to do? And I just kind of was unsure how to kind of broach the subject that I don't think you're going to be the star of the film anymore. And to his credit, he kind of immediately said, he goes, you know, Saul is great, and you should go with him. And we did, and Bones eventually did get out, thank goodness, and ended up playing kind of a gang leader in the jail, who kind of protects Saul, or Ray, as he's known in the film. So that was one connection. The other, and the Rikers film, as I say, is going to be on PBS this spring, and it's really a series, 12 characters. We probably pre-interviewed over 100. Bill Moyers, who I have had the privilege of working with since I was really a teenager, believe it or not, called me up and I said, you know, I said, Bill, he said, Mark, I got something only you can do. I said, Bill, I thought you're retired. I mean, he's retired so many times, I couldn't keep him straight. And he said, well, maybe I'll do one last one, let's get together. We did, and he had been reading the New York Times articles, the articles in the New Yorker, as these exposés over the last 2 years were appearing about just the horrors that were going on Rikers Island. And as he said, you know, we read about Guantanamo, we read about what happened in Afghanistan, at Bagram and other places, and yet right here, only a few miles from where we're all sitting right now, we've got our own horrible, you know, jail where people are being tortured and mistreated, and we just, it's kind of out of sight, out of mind, and he said, I think we need to tell those stories. And so we got together and talked about it, and his reasoning in terms of trying to do a kind of series of testimonials, because of course I said, you know, are we going to try to get into Rikers? That's a little tricky, although I've filmed in quite a number of jails and prisons over the years. And he said, no, we don't care about getting in, we don't care about interviewing corrections officers or interviewing sociologists or criminologists or politicians. We're just going to take the testimony of people who have survived the experience. And he was adamant about it, and I asked why, and he said, well, remember when we worked on the addiction series he had done called Close to Home? I did one of those. And he said the most successful episode of that series, the one that I continue to get feedback, was one called Portrait of Addiction, which was really just 6 to 8 characters telling their stories, all cut together in kind of an archetypal journey of what addiction can do to one, and all with different addictions. And he said that was just talking heads in our language. You know, when you hear that, you're like, oh goodness, you know, yeah, this is going to be tough to promote, you know, just talking heads. But he said that touched more people, and let's see if we can do the same with Rikers, finding characters that we create a composite archetypal journey of what it's like to cross that bridge, survive your time in the jail, because remember, going to jail, you're not convicted. You're accused of a crime, but you are not convicted, and then return. So that's a connection to Slam. And then the final connection is Sonny Soane, who played an instructor in Slam, and actually had taught at Rikers, and that kind of inspired that role. She went on to star in The Wire for 7 years as the lesbian police detective. And she is now directing her first feature documentary called For Love of Baltimore, which I'm executive producing. And it is the story of Baltimore in the year after Freddie Gray's death and the uprising riots that happened and the indictment of 6 police officers, all who got off. And it's inside both the Black Lives Movement and the street activists and the police department. So in a way, it's a little like The Real Wire. It's quite moving, quite powerful, and part of the power of it, going back to what you're saying, is that when you see the parallels that you know, we so often stereotype each other, okay, you know, they're the enemy, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, we're the heroes, or the other way around, you know, we're the bad people, and, you know, they're the heroes. And what this film does so powerfully is that it has the political and the organizing side, but you also see the humanity, and in the humanity and the personal stories, you see the parallels between people who are actually police officers mm-hmm. and what they've gone through, the experiences they've had, and some of the activists, and even some of the former gang leaders who have tried to kind of reform and change their whole life. So that's very powerful. That'll be coming out in the festival run, hopefully this summer and fall, and it'll be on HBO next November. But there I am working with Sonia, somebody that I first met when we did Slam, and I went down to SOBs, and I'll never forget the first time I saw her perform as a poet, as a Slam artist. And that poem that she did is at the climax of the film Slam. So it just shows you how all this stuff is interconnected. And just, you know, I would say, look, I never, it's interesting to hear when people look at your work, I'm so lost in it that I rarely, it's opportunities like this, and I appreciate this opportunity, and I have to say I'm kind of stunned to see so many people. I woke up this morning, it was like 10 degrees, and I was like, I wonder if anybody is even going to get out of their apartments to come. Yeah, so this is, you know, a great opportunity.
Thank you. Well, you're a big draw. You know, I'm so glad that you went into Rikers as well and you introduced that topic, because our community is connected to Rikers. We have a televisiting program whereby parents at Rikers can communicate through a huge Skype-type screen with their children who come here. And so the children come here and they can celebrate a birthday, they can read a book together, and it's set up with another screen at Rikers.
Wow.
And I'm sure that when you did your work at Rikers that you met other poets there, because
absolutely.
I went to a program at Rikers, and of course, just as you say, just going across the bridge and then having to go through security and everything is traumatic just as a visitor. I went to a graduation of some fathers who had taken a parenting workshop, and then they put together sort of a collective chapbook of their poems.
Huh.
And it was just so moving. So did you also connect with any of the poets at Rikers, or what, that wasn't the emphasis this time?
That wasn't the emphasis
yeah, okay.
time, although one or two of the characters in the film are kind of writing their own stories.
Right.
And Lisa Jesse Peterson, who's got a book coming out this spring on her experience as a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
She's a poet. Uh-huh. She's a performance artist. She was in Slam also. Mm-hmm. And she's got a book coming out this spring about what it was like to teach the adolescents in Rikers for 4 or 5 years, what that experience was like.
And as you say, you know, Rikers, sometimes we forget that Rikers is a jail, not a prison.
Exactly.
And that this is a limbo, a metaphorical limbo for people. If they just don't have even $200 to make bail, then they're stuck there.
Let me just add one other thing to that, because somebody that comes out of our kind of, I guess you would call it, a production family, is also behind this series that'll be, the second episode will be on Tuesday or Wednesday evening. It's the Khalif Browder story that's on Spike, and that Jay-Z and Harvey Weinstein are executive producing, but that's the story of the young man that was innocent, you know, but was accused of robbing a knapsack, was put in solitary for 2 years, and came out. Yeah, it was, the first show was on, the second episode will be on. So look, I mean, I think on that subject, and that's, I want to let the people, you know, Moyers people know, because obviously this spring is going to be a big outreach push, and maybe I'll connect them with you, because I think the whole mass incarceration issue, a lot of people felt, including myself, that if we were here last spring, that there was some momentum, and that it was one of the few issues, maybe the only issue, where you had progressives and conservatives coming together in one of the most unusual alliances, you know, the ACLU with the Koch brothers, Cory Booker with Rand Paul, Van Jones with Newt Gingrich. It was very unusual. Now, of course, we'll see how long Jeff Sessions lasts as our Attorney General, but we know we've taken a massive step backwards already. There are you know, new regulations allowing private prisons to, you know, to get back in the business, even though it's proved they're total failures and they cost more. So I think that the issue, which seemed to be moving to some kind of bipartisan reform movement, has been set back, but is more of a challenge now than ever, especially going to what you were saying about organizing. The focus that some states are taking on protesting. Yes. In other words, on making a protest potentially a felon, to try to inhibit and to try to intimidate organizers, because you know, they'll be arrested and they could be charged with a felony. That's an issue that comes up in the film I was just telling you about, For Love of Baltimore. That's what happens to one of the Black Lives Matter young activists, 24-year-old, but who was targeted and repeatedly arrested and faces felony charges. So I think it's, I didn't know about what you were doing. That's fantastic. I mean, it's just the waste of human potential. And you know, again, this isn't something I thought out. It just kind of happened, although I will share with you just a personal anecdote, because as I've been in situations, I've thought like, well, how did I end up doing six or seven films of people behind bars, that this theme of freedom and independence seems to you know, run through a lot of what I've done. I was a child in the 60s, so obviously that had a profound influence. My parents were radicals. So I'm sure I was at the March on Washington, you know, as an 11-year-old, you know, 12-year-old. So I'm sure all of that had a profound influence. But I think what somewhere deep inside me drives part of this is that I lost a friend when I was a teenager who was found hung in a jail cell in Miami-Dade jail. This is right when Easy Rider came out, and those of you who are of my age or older remember, you know, kind of the real culture war that was happening back in the 60s. I always, and I still do wonder, it was reported as a suicide, obviously incredibly traumatic for teenagers, all of us. But I was never at peace with that. I had heard rumors through my life that it wasn't suicide, that he was murdered. I think it's haunted me in some way that I was never conscious of, but when I found myself making these films and giving voice to many of the stories and thinking about the wasted human potential and the wasted money, and just our whole backward way of looking at these issues, I think that's something that's probably driven me.
You know, so you mentioned your family, so I noticed that in 1982, you worked with your father, Al, on Portrait of an American Zealot, and then, more recently, you've worked with your son, Daniel, on Dirty Old Town. So again, sort of making a circle here, are you comfortable talking about what that experience is, working
sure.
with working with family?
Yeah, I'm certainly. I mean, first of all, I think I should share with you, my sister's son went to ethical culture, mm-hmm. so there's a connection. And my mother's memorial in Maplewood, New Jersey was held at ethical mm-hmm. culture. I was very lucky. Look, my father and mother were extraordinary and incredibly youthful. And my father was one of a kind. I never, planned on kind of making this a family business, so to speak, but it is a family business, really. I took great joy in working with my father. I started as an editor. My first major gig was on a film called Gimme Shelter as a teenager, the Maisels film. I eventually got into this business through editing, which led to directing and writing and producing. But I started by editing some of my father's films. Mm-hmm. So that was a great joy that, you know, I started working with Bill Moyers, with my father back then. It was extraordinary. We had an extraordinary relationship. He was an extraordinary man. And I didn't want to force my son. I wanted him to make his own decisions. I have twins, a boy and a girl, who actually went to preschool at the Hudson Guild. And I always thought my daughter was going to be following me. My daughter went to Stuyvesant. She tested in. She went to Wesleyan, which is where I went to school. And my son had, you know, more struggles. He went to Little Red, Elizabeth Irwin, but, you know, had a tougher time with academics, was always interested in imagery, was drawing since he was, you know, could hold a crayon, became a graffiti artist. Of course, my wife held that against me when he was arrested a number of times. And my wife said, you know, you go down to the police station at 4 in the morning, this is your fault, you know, for exposing him to Bones Malone of all people. So I thought, my wife is in the museum world, in the art world, and has worked at every one of the major museums in this city. So I thought my son was set to follow my wife's kind of world, the art world, and that my daughter, who went to Wesleyan, ended up being one of the editors of the Argus, the paper, was going to follow more in my world. One of the mysteries, and I'm sure many of you have seen something similar, somewhere in their early 20s, the signals got synced, it switched, and my son was all of a sudden running around with a camera and his friends and starting to make his own movies. And my daughter got deeper and deeper into the art world, went to Winter Tour, which is the graduate program down in Delaware for art conservation and preservation, and is now an art conservationist and preservationist, works at the Brooklyn Museum. My son is an accomplished filmmaker. So I sometimes shake my head like, how did that happen exactly? But it's a great joy. I mean, he's got his own career, but that we can team up on projects and work together, I feel very, very lucky to be able to do that.
And of course, your company is Blowback Productions. And you have a film called Blowback back in 1991, which I've got to see. I've seen your other things. I haven't seen this.
Film has been hidden.
An insane scientist named Dr. Crack. But at any rate, but you used Blowback as the name of your production company because it's a CIA intelligence term for unintended consequences of covert operations. And so, in other words, what goes around comes around. So is that's also a theme for you, I imagine.
I'm amazed that you brought that one up.
That's my job.
That's been highly classified information. People in my own company haven't seen that film. I'll say two things. First of all, I think the Russian intelligence community is now learning a lot more about the term blowback and the unintended consequences uh-huh. of some of their shenanigans in this
right,
election.
Right. Uh-huh.
Yes, I was honored to win an Emmy back in 88 on The Secret Government, The Constitution in Crisis, which was Moyer's kind of earth groundbreaking look at the Iran-Contra affair. I was there working when Ollie North testified, and the whole thing went down. And that was where I first came across the term. I hadn't heard the term. It's rather popular now. But it was an intelligence term when a covert operation boomerangs and the unintended consequences. And certainly, you know, if you want to take a more metaphoric look, it's kind of, I guess you could call it karma. You know, there's no escape. It somehow comes around. Now, I will admit that that film was a deranged, infantile kind of a freak out by me, because I made it after the election of George Bush Sr. Because I was so horrified at that moment. It's funny now looking back.
Yeah.
You know, what we're dealing with. I had worked on The Secret Government as a producer-editor, won an Emmy, and then here was George Bush, who was obviously the vice president under Reagan, involved in some of the Iran-Contra scandal, but even more what weighed down on my consciousness was he had been the head of the CIA. He was the first CIA director that was ever elected president of the United States. So I was horrified. And I think I had something of a meltdown, a kind of midlife crisis. I made this black comedy, but I would admit it was excessive and insane. So I locked it away for many years. But it's fascinating you brought it up, because when I saw Donald Trump's first press conference, I was so stunned by the infantilism, the deranged quality, that all of a sudden I realized maybe I have to bring blowback out of the mothball, because as embarrassed as I was, I thought now it's pretty hard to be too infantile, too vulgar, too deranged, and it may be time for this kind of crazy black comedy. So you may be hearing a little more about it this summer.
So I'm wondering, you were born in New York City and then you grew up in Maplewood. I'm wondering if growing up in a sleepy little town like that sort of inspired your great fervent love for cities. Because you've done New York, part of your trilogy was Baltimore, Babylon,
Brooklyn,
what did I say? Baltimore, see, but because he does Baltimore, he loves Baltimore too. Brooklyn, Babylon, Baltimore, Los Angeles, I mean, you love big cities.
I do. Look, I was born in New York and lived the first year or two right near the Queens Midtown Tunnel. But the important stop before I ended up as a teenager in suburban New Jersey, in Maplewood, was my parents moved to Elizabeth, New Jersey. And Elizabeth is your classic blue-collar, working-class city. And I grew up in an Italian-American neighborhood where a lot of people worked at the Singer factory. And my parents at that point, as I said, were radicals. My father worked for the Jersey Central Railroad as a mechanic and as a union organizer. And my mother worked for Westinghouse, as a union organizer. And we lived in a two-family home. So I think that experience, because I look at, I have three sisters. My sister, I'm the oldest. My sister Nicole was a year younger. Her son, she lives only 20 blocks from here, and it was her son that went to ethical culture. My two younger sisters, Danielle and Juliet, they didn't really have the formative experience in Elizabeth that we did, the suburbs was much more where they came of age. And they live in the suburbs. My youngest sister lives in Maplewood, amazingly enough, and my other sister, Danielle, lives up in Westchester. So I think it was really Elizabeth that had, and it's interesting because, you know, we read about every day, you know, the so-called white working class, you know, had liberals and progressives looked down and ignored, and, you know, is this the new silent majority? I grew up in that world, and I think that is really where this, I guess you could call it, even though it wasn't certainly looked that way, but the cosmopolitan, the idea of a mix of humanity, the idea of being on the stoop, you know, being on the street, all of that, I think, comes from having grown up in Elizabeth, New Jersey, in that world. And I think that, you know, the film you're going to see, or some of you will see this afternoon, Class Divide, I think, you know, that's what the subtext is how do we keep cities vital, keep cities a mix of humanity. The magic of New York, the miracle and the mystery of New York is the mix. Mm-hmm. That somewhere in this city is every kind of human being that has ever existed from every spot on this globe. That creates a unique energy that we've all experienced. I see it in this room here, but we walk down the streets, we get on the subways. That is why everybody wants to come to this city. That's why they call it the city of the world, the world city. So if we lose that, if it becomes just a gated community, a gilded cage, you lose the very magic that attracts people here in the first place. So that is the great challenge. And I'm not pretending to have any answers, but that the film that will be shown here this afternoon is really from children's perspective, from two different sides of the street, on how this world is changing and how one tries to hold on to that magic, that diversity.
Yeah, and I imagine now, thank you for clarifying that about the coming of age piece of it, because I think that helps me to understand some of the documentaries, some of the films that you've made about different people, because your life at a very important time of your life was filled with diversity. So we have, you know, godfathers and sons, and we also have about the Harlem, sort of the Harlem kingpin there, and we also have the Protocols of Zion about anti-Semitism. So you really, you know, you sort of appreciated all these different stories and then lifted up their stories in a very important way. And then, of course, not to forget music, the blues.
Well, so. you spoke about music, and, you know, I love music. It's great that you use it in your gatherings. The music in Class Divide is key by Marc Levin. And it's funny how that happened, because believe it or not, he went to Columbia High School before me, but and grew up in Maplewood, South Orange. But I didn't know him then. I actually was walking by a demonstration of a brownstone in Chelsea where people were being displaced by a greedy landlord, and they were on the street protesting. We were actually filming there. You'll see a little bit of it in the documentary. And I ran into an old buddy of mine who has always been an organizer. He said to me, what are you doing? I told him a little about this film, Class Divide. And he said, well, you know, what kind of music are you going to put in the film? I said, wow, great you asked that question. I'm struggling. What's the sound of Chelsea? You know, what's you know, it's such a mixed community. And we started talking, and he said, well, you know who Marc Levin is? And I do know who Marc Levin is. Marc Levin is probably one of the preeminent guitar players, modern avant-garde jazz, even rock, experimental rock, and composer. And, you know, I knew his work through the composer John Zorn, who actually did the score for Protocols of Zion. So I knew who Marc Levin was, but I said, well, why are you suggesting Marc? He goes, well, he led the squatters movement in the late 80s in Chelsea. They took over a building, and they refused to abandon it, and eventually they got the city to give it to some of the people in the neighborhood. And he's very politically active. You should get in touch with him. So I said, that's great, Lee, and I did. In fact, he had the email for him. I got in touch with him. We got together. So that's, if you see this movie this afternoon, the music is, it is a musical in a way. And the music ties it all together, and he did a brilliant job. But yeah, music is absolutely essential. You know, you mentioned Godfathers and Sons. That's kind of a look at the Chicago blues, Chess Records, and kind of the connection of that music, which had such an influence on my generation, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, Eric Clapton. It all came out of the Chicago Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, Chuck Berry, all came out of that music. But what was the connection between that and today's hip-hop? Mm-hmm. And Marshall Chess, the son of Leonard Chess and Chess Records, and Chuck D go back to Chicago to kind of try to discover that. That's what that movie. And then there was a feature, Cadillac Records, which Beyonce was actually, and she was fantastic. And I don't think that film has ever gotten the attention that it deserves. It was actually on TV last night. And I was executive producer on that. And then you mentioned Protocols of Zion. John Zorn, I don't know how many of you are aware, he's one of the modern geniuses, jazz composition, but he's also very much involved in a revival of Jewish music, as a group called Masada. And he and I teamed up on that film, which sadly is more relevant now than ever, given these recent attacks on some of the Jewish cemeteries in New York and around the country. And that was, of course, inspired by the tragedy of 9/11, and then in my neighborhood there were three delis that I knew the owners of. They were all Arab Americans that I was friendly with, and in the days after 9/11, just going in and trading stories, and I heard over and over again this street rumor, this urban rumor, that no Jews died in the World Trade Center, and I was just like, what, are you kidding me? Are you out of your mind? And these were people I knew. And then one night, I was taking a taxi ride home, and I was, again, you know, the smoke was still rising, got in a conversation with a young Egyptian-American cab driver who seemed very bright and well-informed, and we were talking about everything that was happening. And at one point, he repeated this, you know, no Jews died that day. And I said, come on. You know, you seem like a pretty bright guy. You can't believe that. And he goes, oh, it was all written. And I was like, what? He goes, yeah, it was all written in the Protocols of the Elders of Zion. And now I knew what the Protocols of the Elders of Zion was. This czarist forgery that pretended to be the secret minutes of a Jewish cabal at the end of the 19th century to, you know, take over the world, and it was used it was popularized in this country by Henry Ford, believe it or not. And then Hitler got a hold of it, and it was very much part of Nazi propaganda. I was just stunned, I went on a journey. It's really the only film I've done where I appear in the film, you know, a little more like kind of a Michael Moore film or something where the filmmaker is actually there, and I did confront not only the Arab American community here in Brooklyn and Patterson, but the neo-Nazi movement in West Virginia. And, you know, that was quite a journey and quite a shocking, and to see its resurgence now, and to read some of this stuff I just saw. In fact, this morning, Steve Bannon, this book that he's embraced, which promotes some of this anti-Semitic vile. So yes, that and John Zorn did the score to that. So, you know, we've been close. But music has always been an important part of my work.
I know we could probably go on talking forever, but we do need to wind it up.
Sure.
So I wonder if you could sort of set up for us. Now, you're not able to stay this afternoon, right? So could you set up for us Class Divide, which many of us will be watching this afternoon?
Great. Class Divide is the final part of a trilogy of films that I did for HBO on how these global economic forces actually impact real people's lives. The first film was Shmata, Rags to Riches to Rags, about the rise and fall of a garment center. And I think HBO was kind of stunned just by the feedback they got on that film. It was kind of expanding the subject matter for HBO. They normally, I mean, I've known Sheila Nevins, who's the head of HBO documentaries, for years. And whenever I would bring up an idea about the political economy, she'd look at that, yeah, go take that to your friend Bill Moyers, you know, we don't do that kind of stuff here. But because somehow in the conversation we were having, she was like, you know, my pants are made in Vietnam, my blouse is made in Bangladesh, you know, nothing I'm wearing is made here. And I looked at her, you know, because this conversation was probably, I don't know, 2008, 2007. I was like, Sheila, you just woke up to that? That's pretty old news. You know, I mean, the shmata business is long gone. And she looked at me and she goes, shmata, great title. And I was like, but what's the film? She goes, oh, you'll figure it out. So that's how that film started. But it ended up being this look at the garment center, but as a microcosm of, you know, what we're hearing again, manufacturing leaving, being able to work for a living wage, the death of unionism, all of those issues in play. Then we did a follow-up film called Hard Times Lost on Long Island, which was about the sons and daughters of people who had worked in the garment industry and who had become white-collar professionals, and yet were devastated by the crash of 2008. And face long-term unemployment and a real challenge to ever regain the kind of financial footing they once had. So we were looking for what is the final film in this trilogy, and we had actually gone to Florida to look at the housing crisis, had gone to the Bay Area where the Silicon Valley gentrification was already moving very quickly. And one afternoon, Daphne Pinkerson, the producer, and I were sitting on the High Line on 26th Street, and I have my studios on 26th Street in the 601, the Starrett Lehigh building, looking out on the Hudson River, and I live on 26th Street, so I have been walking to work for 17 years, and that walk of four or five blocks, I've seen the changes, which you've seen up here on the Upper West Side, we've seen all over the city, but in a way, especially after 2004 and the zoning changes around the High Line, Chelsea became kind of what you would call hyper-gentrification, you know, just went into hyperspeed, and I would go away for a few weeks, come back, a building had disappeared, a new building was going up. I mean, it was moving so fast, so there were many mornings and the evenings when I'd walk back and forth, and I'd wonder, you know, how do you tell this story? This is kind of amazing what I'm seeing every day. And there was so much history on that walk also, because when you walk by 7th and 8th on 26th, you're actually walking by the Chelsea TV studios where Rachel Roy does her talk show. But that, believe it or not, is where the famous Players studio was in the teens. That's Charlie Chaplin, Mary Pickford, and Douglas Fairbanks Jr. That's where they started before they moved to Hollywood, was on 26th Street. Then you go to the next block between 8th and 9th, that's Penn South, you know, which was created by the ILGWU, by the garment industry, and it remains one of the last affordable housing, you know, kind of middle-income housing developments in all of New York City. And then you go the next block between 9th and 10th, you come to the Elliott Chelsea housing, which is public housing. And that's where the Hudson Guild is, which came out of the settlement movement, which you were mentioning, and where I used to take my kids to daycare. They went to preschool at Hudson Guild. Their first teacher was, believe it or not, Whoopi Goldberg's mother. Whoopi Goldberg grew up in the Elliott Chelsea projects. And then you take the next block, and that's where you hit the High Line, and that's where you also hit the galleries, because, as you know, Chelsea has taken the art movement and the art gallery scene from Soho, has kind of moved into Chelsea. And then you come to the Starrett Lehigh Building. So I've been thinking for quite a while, and Daphne and I were sitting on the High Line and talking, okay, what are we going to propose to HBO? And you see all these tourists come up. There's an empty billboard frame there on the spur where you can sit on a bench and you can look out, and all the tourists come up there and take pictures. And you hear people speaking French and Chinese and Japanese and Portuguese, and they're taking these pictures. And they're sending them all over the world, and I started thinking, do they have any idea what's in that picture? You know, what's behind that picture? Because there on the right-hand side of the frame was an old building, a storage building, but that has now been taken over by the newest elite private school in Manhattan, which is called Avenues, the World School. And across the street was the Elliott Chelsea Public Housing Project. And all of a sudden, it just hit us. It was like, there it is. The haves, the have-nots, one frame. It all depends on the frame you look at, you know, you look through, because I've been in this neighborhood in Chelsea. I mean, when I first moved in and my wife's parents came to visit us, I lived in a garment factory. It was still the flower district, the garment district, and I remember my mother-in-law broke down and started crying. She couldn't believe this is where her daughter ended up. She was devastated. If she had lived to see now, she would be quite happy. I mean, given what's happened, you know, I've got two hotels on the street and there are all sorts of famous people in the building. So it hit us then, okay, this might be a way to tell the story, which is literally located right on a corner of 26th and 10th Avenue, the High Line running through, the world's architects and money from all over the world pouring in, and on one side you have the most privileged New York children going to this new high-tech school, and on the other side you have kids from low-income families that are struggling, and yet they're witnessing this. There's no way to ignore it. And they see each other, and there are a lot of stereotypes they carry. Let's do a documentary from their youthful perspective, their fresh eyes, not burdened by all the history. What do they see happening? So that's what Class Divide is.
And I know you're all going to want to stay to see it this afternoon. So thank you so very, very much.